takes glory. Let me tell you, when Jesus gets glory, and that's when somebody repents of their sin and comes to the cross of Calvary, bows before him and calls upon his name and believes in his death and his burial and his resurrection. I want to know how many people here tonight, you're going to face God one day, and I tell you, the truth's going to come out. It's appointed unto men once to die, and after this is the judgment. If you're here tonight and you say, Reggie, I know that my name is written down. I have believed on in, I trust Jesus Christ as my Savior, that he died in my place for my sin, shed his blood. I'm trusting his blood. I'm not trusting my baptism, not trusting how good I am. I know in whom I have believed. Would you slip your hand tonight and praise him and thank him and say, God, thank you for saving my old wretched soul that should have been in hell. That's a beautiful sight I'm looking at out there tonight. That's a blessing, amen. But I'm telling you, everything he preaches is going to happen. It's going to happen, amen. It's going to happen. He's coming back. We said the theme of this meeting would be the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. We've been hearing some, I'm telling you, unbelievable good preaching on it. Now, if you couldn't raise your hand tonight, you'd say, Brother Reggie, I'd sure like to. God's dealing with me, and I need prayer. I tell you, there's a wrestling in my soul. The devil's telling me not to, and the Holy Ghost is telling me to. Would you slip your hand and say, Brother Reggie, I'm not saved, but pray for me. I tell you, God's dealing with me. I don't want to die and go to hell. I want to receive Christ as my Savior. I want my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Would you slip your hand up? I don't know what else to do to ask you. We're begging you. We're pleading with you. Would you slip your hand up? At least let us pray for you. Lift your hand up high in the air and say, pray for me. Pray for me. Anywhere in this building at all, real quick. Not going to take a long time. I don't see a hand in the house right now. If there is, I've missed you, and I don't want to miss you. Anywhere in the house, is there a hand? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the good messages we've heard today, and we thank you for the Word of God that's been preached tonight from the book of Genesis to the book of Revelation. And Lord, I want to thank you that there's going to come a day when you're coming back to get us. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we'll be changed. The dead in Christ will rise. God will put on, have a new glorified body translated, Lord, out of here to ever be with the Lord. I thank you, God, tonight. There's also coming a time when you come back to this earth with your saints. Lord, to conquer Satan and his armies, to conquer this evil, wicked world, and to rule with a rod of iron. And I'm thankful, God, that in the end, you're going to put down all rebellion and you'll deliver the kingdom up to the Father. And there'll be a new heaven and a new earth and an eternal kingdom where Jesus Christ is King of kings and Lord of lords. And there'll be no more sin, no more curse. And Lord, it's all going to be behind us. And Lord, we praise you. We look at this wicked, sinful, cursed world and the literal sewage that is just coming, a sewer lagoon of wickedness out of hell. God, we look forward to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, Lord, we realize tonight that you said, straight is the gate, and narrow is the way, and few there be that find it. And Lord, you said, many there be which road to destruction. And God, I just pray tonight, Lord, that you'll deal with people. I wish, Lord, this whole county was here tonight. I would, God, that the whole world would hear the message tonight. And Lord, there's people that are going to wind up in hell. They just never heard, I guess, Lord. I don't know, man. I tell you, God, I don't understand why people aren't concerned about their souls. But Lord, we want to go on, like the Hebrew writer said. We want to go on from being saved to growing in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And God, I pray that it happened here this week. And I pray folks to be able to leave here with hope in their heart and the Lord Jesus Christ coming again. Lord, that's the only hope. We're not looking for some president to fix it. We're not looking for Congress to fix it. They can't fix it. Lord, you're going to be fixing this thing, and you're going to fix it right. And I tell you, I bless your holy name for it. Love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'll tell you what, turn around, shake hands to 5, 6, 15, 20 people. Say, who are you and where in the world you come from? And we're going to have a little break in the action here and then have another message. Thank you. you, Sister Rachel. Amen. Turn her right up there. All right. Well, it's 7:29. We're going to try to keep things moving. Brother Josh, thank you for that great, great, wonderful Bible message tonight. I'll tell you what, that's preaching. Amen. That's Bible preaching. I like that Bible preaching. I tell you, I like people that believe the Bible and preach the Bible. I love it. Amen. I'll tell you what, the harder they preach it, the better I like it. And just a couple of things in the morning. We'll probably start about 9:30 in the morning. The kids are getting up here, start singing. We'll get a church service about 9:45. About 10:45, we're going to start the sending service for Brother Jason Waltice and her family going to Mexico. And I just want to say how much I appreciate all the church being out. We got a lot of folks that are gone, but we got a lot of folks that are here. And I thank you for that. Danny will be preaching tomorrow night, and I don't know for sure right now who else. But anyway, let's tell you what, let's come, Brother Glenn. Let's just sing a couple of verses of one song, and we're going to get right into the message tonight. I'm trying to think. Hang on just a minute. Is Ari Kane here somewhere? There you are, Ari. Come up here real quick, Ari. This man from South Carolina, he's been here this spring. I tell you what, it's such a blessing. I just want you to give a brief word of testimony, if you will. Would you do that, please?
Well, I'm really nervous. Should have paid attention to speech class. First, I want to thank the Lord for his salvation, like Brother Joshua preached, Behold the Man. And thank you for the message and giving us a new vision on Behold the Man and all his different forms. Like I said, I would like to thank the Lord for his salvation, his grace and mercy to me. I was saved when I was 5 and grew up in church. My parents had me in church. I met my wife. She was saved on the bus route. In Chicago, we got married, and I also like to thank the church for all the hard work that you guys have done in the spring revival and this revival. I saw you guys online through sermon audio, been listening to the messages, and just really enjoyed the spirit and speaking to the young men, young people here. You guys have really something special in your pastor here. When I first started listening to him, I kind of turned it off. And I mean, I grew up under that kind of preaching, but under preachers that really didn't seem to love the people. It was preaching hard, preaching right, but they didn't have the sense of love. And I didn't really want anything to do with it. But kept coming back and listening, and I can sense the love that he has to his people here. And you young people truly have something special in here. And like Brother Reg Kelly preached last night on glorifying God in everything that you do. I was memorized the passage in 2 Chronicles 19, verse 6 and 7. It's when Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, he was setting up judges in the land of Judah. And it says, he said to the judges, take heed what you do, for you judge not for man, but for the Lord who is with you in the judgment. Wherefore, now let the fear of the Lord be upon you. Take heed and do it. For there is no iniquity with the Lord our God, nor respect of persons, nor taking of gifts. And like Brother Kelly said last night, what am I doing? Who am I doing stuff for? And it's so easy to get my eyes on the world and just what's going on in my life and not keeping it on God. Why do I do stuff? Why do you do stuff? Make it for the Lord and not for yourself, and you'll be happy.
God bless you, brother. I'll tell you, I appreciate this man. He just got a sweet heart about him and a good spirit. And I'll tell you, I appreciate that. And it's just hard for us to express how much we appreciate all of you coming, because these people do. All I do around here is preach and kind of run my mouth. And these people do all the work. And man, I'll tell you what, I just appreciate it so much. I'm going to ask a guy to come right now, Brother Vinny Club. Become very appreciative of this man, and he lives here in Missouri, but he is involved in government, and he's trying to make a godly Christian influence and effect upon the government of Missouri through his life. And his father-in-law preached for us. How long has that been? A year or so ago, maybe, or I don't know when. Was several months ago. But I asked Vinny just to come and share a word of testimony with you. Vinny, just have the Lord.
Thank you, brother. You know, I'm not a great orator by any stretch of the imagination, but when Lord offers you an opportunity to get up and lift up his name, you kind of want to do that. And you know, God inhabits the praises of his people for sure. You know, I got saved in 1994, lived about 6 years, and the sin of the old nature, and then the Lord brought me into himself. I just dedicated myself to the Lord at that time, and he quickly brought me to a place where the preaching of God's word was fast. You know, it was sure. And for those of you that attend church here, you know, you need to make sure that you appreciate your pastor. He's no special man. He's got a magnifying glass on his life just because of his position. He's like the rest of us, but he does have a heart for the word of God, the inspired, authorized word of God. He has a heart for the Lord Jesus Christ, and he has a heart for, you know, the flock that he's shepherding. So just always keep him up in your prayers. And I appreciate his friendship over the last few years for sure. You know, I was thinking, and I just turned 47 about a week or so ago, and I started re-examining everything in my life. You know, you start the great events in your life, Reg, you just kind of think about how they affected you and things of that nature. And of course, me and my wife have our 19th anniversary come Monday, so she's put up with me for that long. Praise the Lord for that. But, you know, a few weeks back, I was up in Jeff City, and it's just one of those times when I don't think I've really felt depression in that much. It seems like the world around me was burning, like everything was on fire. Every time I took a step, phone call for my mom's health, just every situation, close friends had phone calls while I was all out there. It just seemed like everything was burning down around me, and I didn't know what to do. And, you know, the only thing I knew what to do was just take that step. You know, take one step at a time, trust in Christ. He's going to handle everything at the end of it all. He's in control of everything. But he kind of revealed something to me. And, you know, we go through seasons of our life where he teaches us things until we get it. and then we learn it. And then once we forget it again, he usually takes us back through that again. But, you know, the biggest issues that I have, he was revealing to me, the biggest issues I have was not in necessarily what was going on around me, but it's the things that were happening inside of me. It was my own self. You know, it wasn't necessarily my weaknesses that hindered me, but it was my strengths. It wasn't necessarily the darkness that I had in my life, but the perceived light that I had. That's what was stopping and hindering God from working in my life. You know, the question I have to ask myself, and we probably need to ask ourselves, is what, you know, are we going to settle for what we can work up, or are we going to search after what God can bring down? You know, the devil doesn't really care about what decisions you might make tonight. As a believer, he doesn't really care the feelings you might have, the altar calls you might come to, but he wants to stop you from being obedient, right? You know, he's never going to fail us. He's never going to stray from us. So why should we really worry about that? You know, why should we fear? We have him. We just got to keep our eyes focused on him, keep set on him. And I just want to close out and you know, I'm looking forward to some more preaching. But, you know, revival's not necessarily about seeking something. It's not about a feeling. It's not about a circumstance. It's about seeking someone. And that someone is the Lord Jesus Christ. It's about him. It's about his glory. It's about his honor. It's about our surrender to him and being obedient. What do we have? And which we hear, obviously, from the preaching of his word. But thank you for your friendship, Brother Reg. I'm going to hand it back over to you, brother.
This guy's the real deal. He's willing to go into the fire. And that's what I think you could kind of pick up from me. It's not what we're necessarily doing here at church. It's what we're going to do when we leave out of here and what we're going to do when we face the opposition. And I told somebody the other day, I've never been cussed out so much. I showed my wife just one message that I got this week. And it had, honey, what would you guess? 30 or more cussings at me. And, you know, I kind of laugh. I'm used to it now in a way. It's kind of funny because I think, well, you little old coward. Anybody cuss behind the phone, you know. But the truth about it is our forebears in Christianity were burned at the stake. They were fed to lions just for believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. And things are probably going to get pretty bad. Now, you listen to me. There's a difference between God's wrath and man's wrath. God's wrath will be during the tribulation period, and the church is not going to be here. But man's wrath, the first century was horribly persecuted. Probably the first generation of the church was horribly persecuted. It could be that the last generation church will be horribly persecuted. I'm telling you, there are people in government, and Benny can tell you this, and Hannah can tell you this, they hate Christianity. And if they have their way about it, they will snuff it out of this country. And so, let's just sing. Can you hit that, revive us again? We praise thee, O God. I'm going to ask you to stand with me one last time, and then I'm going to bring a message. It's going to be a little bit different tonight. But I hope it'll be a blessing to you. I don't know if I can get the right key on that or not, but we'll take off on it. I hate to bother you. Just hit me one time on it. We praise thee, O God. Revive us, fill his heart with thy love, may soul be rekindled, fire from above. Hallelujah, thine the glory.
Hallelujah,
amen.
Hallelujah,
thine the glory. Revive us again. I'm going to ask my dear friend Leon Mitchell right now just to pray for us as we begin to preach this message. Brother Leon, dear friend, godly man, godly wife, and just a wonderful bunch of kids, and I appreciate them so much. Brother Leon, would you pray, and then I'm going to preach. You may be seated tonight. Take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. Before I start preaching the message tonight, we did this about a week or so ago at church, and I'm going to just run through it real quick with you. But many of you know this is the candlestick in the tabernacle or in the temple and the lampstand. And we were just showing there'd be a blessing to you if you love the Word of God and just want some confirmation about that we have a sovereign, providential God who's totally got it all. The lampstand had the main shaft right here, and it had three branches out on each side. We went through, I don't want to take very long on this, but their lamps were up here on top. But down through each branch, God told them to put a bowl and a knop and a flower. And that's what Moses did. He said, do it exactly. He said, make it after the pattern that I give you. And just to make it real quick tonight, that if you add up each of those three, and by the way, three is a number of divinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. Nine, which is three threes, is the number of the Holy Spirit, who is God. And so you have nine and nine. On the shaft, though, there's four sets of threes, which is 12, which is 12, number 12, number governance. And then we have on the side, the same thing on the other side. And just to show you this here, this is such a blessing to me that our God is eternally. I think they're passing out some handouts there tonight. But let's do a little math right here. We got three nines on this side. How many is that? Three times nine? That's 27. We got 12. And then we got three nines again. It's 27. So 27 and 12 and 27 is 66. The Bible said in Psalms 119, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. That candlestick is a picture of your Bible. But the amazing part of this is your Bible at that time didn't have 66 books in it as far as what man had his hands on. That's telling you that God pre-wrote in the eternal counsel of God how many Bibles was going to be, how many books was going to be in this Bible. And so I hope that'd be a blessing to you. Now, this is going to be totally different than what you just heard. My goodness sakes alive, I feel like what I'm going to do is totally different. Not going to be a little bit of teaching, maybe, and some encouragement to you, if I can figure this thing out. All righty. Hand me one of them handouts. Boys, you got any of them handouts handy anywhere? Is there any left? If I could have one of those. But let's look at Matthew chapter 24 tonight. Now, you know, in the Bible history, thank you very much. Appreciate that, brother. In Bible history, there is, you go back to Abram, you had Genesis. And of course, in Genesis, mankind fell. And then God made that promise in Genesis 3:15. What did God promise in Genesis 3:15? He promised a Messiah. He promised a Savior to cure what had happened with Adam and Eve. We know him as Jesus Christ. He's the last Adam. And God made that great promise about bruising the serpent's head. That is a prophecy, and so that's going to happen. That's part of what he preached a while ago, was the bruising in Revelation 19, is the bruising of the serpent's head. Revelation 20:10, when Satan's cast in lake of fire, that's part of the fulfillment of the bruising of the serpent's head. Now, you go on through Genesis, you come to Genesis chapter 12, and God has promised this seed of woman. So we know that it's a man, and it was Jesus Christ, the God-man, behold the man. So then you come to this chapter 12, and you learn of a man by the name of Abram. And Abram was called out of the land of Ur of Chaldees. It was a pagan, just a pagan mess. And yet God reached down into a pagan mess and called a man out of Ur of Chaldees by the name of Abram. And in chapter 12, he begins to make him promises, and he starts him on a journey. He's going to give him a land. And of course, it takes off from there. But Abram eventually is called Abraham. He changed his name to a father of multitudes. And then Abram has a son. And what's his son's name? Isaac. He had a son by the name of Isaac. And then Isaac had, these are called the patriarchs. And Isaac had a son. His name's called what? Jacob. All right. Jacob has an encounter with God up there in Genesis, and God changes his name. He changes his name to what? To Israel. Israel. And Jacob has 12 sons, and they are called the sons of Jacob, the sons of Israel. All right. And then we have what's called the 12 tribes of Israel, of which we call the nation of Israel, who become known as the Hebrew people. Okay. And what we know today, and even in the Bible, the Jews. All right. Now, I'm going to submit to you tonight that the nation Israel is God's prophetic time clock. Now, we're having a theme here of the second coming of Jesus Christ. And so we're going to look at this tonight, what we can learn from the Bible about keeping ourselves, our eyes open, being watchful, being aware, and looking for the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we're going to be looking at Israel tonight. And Israel's just a tiny little nation. It's not as far as from here to the Kansas line wide. About 200 mile long, about 50 mile wide, little old country. I've been there three times. And it doesn't, I mean, it's just there's a lot of stuff in it, but it is not very big. But it dominates world news. I'm going to give you some things pretty soon that's pretty interesting. I actually got off into an entirely different thing, and I talked to Joel about it tonight, and we're going to be working on it, but I'll just save this till later. I'm trying about to jump the gun on you. Let's look at Matthew chapter 23, and we're going to look at verse 33. Now, keep in mind that Jesus here is at the end of his Olivet discourse. He's told about, he's literally taking them through AD 70, the destruction of Jerusalem, the captivity and the dispersion of Israel, this nation I'm talking about. Okay, they are a nation. They are a nation. They're a people, the Jewish people, Israel. And by the way, our Savior that he just preached about is a Jew. He is a Hebrew. He is a descendant of the seed of Abraham. And all that's very important because it has to be exactly like God prophesied that it would be. So when Jesus is preaching here, he stops after he literally describes the second coming of Jesus Christ. Read it with me up in verse number 27. After the tribulation period that's given to you before here, when he hits verse 27, he says, "As the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Now this is at the end of the tribulation. This is the second coming where he comes with his saints. We've already been with him at the marriage supper of the Lamb, the judgment seat of Christ, the marriage supper of the Lamb, and we're the church is the bride of Christ, and we're coming back to the earth for a 1,000-year honeymoon. And this is what this scene is here. And he said, verse 28, for wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together. He literally read about that while ago in Revelation 19, at the end of that chapter, when he calls all the fowls of heaven to eat the bodies of the armies that's been killed in this great battle over there in the Middle East. In verse number 29, it says, immediately after the tribulation of those days, God's telling you what, the sun shall be darkened, the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then he says this, then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. This is what's called the revelation, or the second coming of Jesus Christ. And verse 31, he shall send his angels with a great sound of trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds of heaven, one end to the other. And if you go back into there's some passages of scripture that a lot of people think are the rapture, not the rapture at all. When God goes into the kingdom, he's going to separate the sheep and the goats. And those that are lost are not going into the kingdom with God. That's just what the Bible teaches. And so, but then he breaks, totally breaks. And he says in verse 32 this, now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Now, there's something we need to get a hold of here. Jesus is going to talk to the generation that was listening to him, but he's also going to talk to the generation that's going to be when the fig tree puts forth its leaves. So it's two different generations he's talking. He's talking to the present generation. He's going to go talk to the future generation. And he says in verse 35, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. In other words, what I have told you is going to happen. It is going to happen. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, not the angels in heaven, but my Father only. Then he tells us in verse 37, he begins to back up now and gives you something. Somebody says, Reggie, what is the sign in verse 30? Well, let me tell you, the just shall live by faith. We do not live by signs. And you better get out of the sign business, because the Antichrist, as we approach that, and I'm trying to hold back some stuff that I'm got a hold of, and that, you know, that deals with this thing. But he is going to be a person of signs. The Jews seek a sign. We live by faith. If your toe grows, I'm glad for you, but that don't change my effect about my faith. If somebody literally rose from the dead out here tonight, that's great, I guess, but I'd have my questions about it. That's not going to shake my faith in Jesus Christ. And you better get this settled, because as times approach, you're going to see false Christs, false signs, all kinds of wonders, all kinds of junk going on. By the way, it already is. There's a new religion popping up every day out here somewhere, it seems like, and a bunch of stupidity that people are following and claiming to be. But I mean, I will tell you what that sign is, I believe. It's light. See, when God shuts the sun off and the stars, the moon's not going to shine. He will shut the universe down into darkness. Here's the deal. Mankind rejected the light of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. They want darkness. They do not want his light upon their life. So they reject him, and God's going to give them exactly what they wanted. He's going to shut the lights off on this universe. And the Bible says literally in the book of Revelation that they'll be so dark that they will gnaw their tongues in darkness. And then the Bible talks about the fact that when he comes, that light, that he said he will just, in Thessalonians, he will destroy them with the brightness of his coming. There's not going to be no big, Satan's not going to have a chance. The lost, he will blind them with the brightness of his coming. And I literally believe that sign is when that light that has the lightning strikes. I was telling somebody yesterday, I watched that video of those five precious young people in Indiana that were killed by a lightning strike under a tree in a city park. And I mean, just folks limited to four of them just collapsed on the ground. The fifth one, he was leaning up against it, he just slowly fell to the ground. But that lightning strike hit them. They didn't know what hit them. They were dead and didn't know what happened. And I'm going to tell you something. When our Savior comes back in this scene here, it's going to be like a lightning strike to this whole world. He's coming in. It'll be a blinding power. He will destroy them with the brightness of his coming. Now, pray for me that I'll keep moving, because my mind gets to running here and there and all that stuff and connecting scriptures. But that's what I believe that'll be. Now, he comes back then in verse 37, says the days of Noah and so forth. And another passage of scripture talking about the days of Lot. Well, how many knows we're there? The days of Lot, Sodom and Gomorrah, perversion of every kind. We're there. So that's already around. Now, go back to chapter 21 and let's look at verse number 18. Chapter 21 and verse number 18. Matthew chapter 21 and verse number 18. Now in the morning, as he returned into the city, he hungered, and when he saw, and look, listen to this. Now remember, this is before what we just read. This is before that. He's told them about a parable of the fig tree, but he had already told those disciples something about a fig tree here. He said, when he saw a fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing thereon but leaves only. Now, let me just give you something here. Please pray for me. I am so long-winded, it's pitiful. Say amen, go ahead. Amen. This is about Israel. This fig tree, it's Israel. But there's an application to Christianity. There's always an application. A church can have leaves and look real good, but no fruit. It's a picture of a religious lost man. Be real careful about that. You can, boy, he said, man, ain't them nice leaves, stuff like that. But he said, no fruit. And you want to be careful, because the Bible said you'll know them by, not by their leaves, by their fruit. Okay? So there's an application there. Just started to throw that in. So he says there, and said unto it, he spoke to this fig tree, let no fruit grow on thee henceforth forever. Now let me throw something at you. There, I got so tickled at that brother preaching today. He said he wouldn't say post it. He don't eat post toasties. He don't eat post nothing. He won't say off to the doctor nothing. Now he's talking about doctrinal beliefs about the second coming of Jesus Christ there. This passage has been twisted and wrested to make people think that God is done with Israel. But it's not so. What he's telling them, the fig tree application to Israel is going to be finished. And it's going to change. And what I'm going to present to you in your piece of paper that you've got there tonight, in the past, before the cross, Jesus taught that Israel was a vine. Okay? Israel started out that nation, there was a vine. And by the way, he tells the parable of the vineyard, and he digged around it, planted it, brought it into the land, planted it there, and what did they do? They killed the husband. Said, this is the son. And that it's a picture of what Israel did to Jesus Christ when he talks about Israel as a vine. From the cross to the second coming, the nation of Israel is a fig tree. You'll have your tribulation period in here at the second coming of Christ. You'll have your tribulation period. At the end of that, Christ comes back. We meet him in the air here. Well, I'm not a very good artist. But he comes back at the end of the tribulation and begins this 1,000-year reign that Brother Josh was preaching on. Six times it says 1,000 years. Amen. God means it. Amen. He's going to rule and reign on this earth for 1,000 years with a rod of iron. And boy, that'll be a wonderful time to be around. We're going to be there. We're going to rule and reign with him, by the way. What your Bible says. During this time, Israel will be what's it called? An olive tree. And those are the three trees that represent Israel through history. So we're going to look a little bit about what we can learn from Israel in the light of the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So now I want you to go back to Matthew chapter 24 and verse number 32. Chapter 24 and verse number 32 again. And he says there in that passage of scripture, in verse number 32, he said, now learn a parable of the fig tree. When its branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, know that summer's nigh. So likewise ye, when you see all these things, know that it is near. What things? When you see Israel as a fig tree putting on its leaves with no fruit, dead spiritually, know that my coming is at hand. We are there. And we're going to talk about that tonight. And just pray, I hope you pray. Jesus is speaking now to the leaders of the nation of Israel. He began his ministry in chapter 5 of Matthew with the Sermon on the Mount, with 8 blessings. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed and blessed and blessed. There's actually 9, but one of the those are, it's a double blessing. The last one, the persecution. He began his ministry with 8 blessings, but he ends his ministry in Matthew 23 with 8 cursings. Can I tell you something? If you won't receive the blessings of God, you'll wind up with the cursings of God. There's no question about that. And so he ends that, his earthly ministry with those 8 cursings right there in Matthew 23 that we talked about a while ago. Verse 36 in the old, is the Old Testament. In, watch verse 36. Let's see. Let me get, I don't seem like I'm going to write. Matthew. Okay, I'm sorry. Matthew chapter 20. Let's go to Matthew now. Chapter 23. Let's go back to verse 33. He's at the end of these 8 cursings. And he says to this generation of these Israeli people, this people of Israel, he said, "You generation of vipers." Now, I'll tell you, Jesus wouldn't get many revivals calling people vipers in the day, would he? God, can you imagine a preacher getting up and calling everybody that rejects him a viper? You snake? No wonder they crucified him, amen. But he said, "You generation of vipers, how can you escape the damnation of hell? Wherefore, I send unto you prophets and wise men and scribes. Some of them you shall kill and crucify. Some of them you shall scourge in your synagogues and persecute them from city to city." Now, I'm going to submit to you that this is probably what's going to be happening to the church before the Lord comes and takes us out. There is a hatred of Christianity, and I'll tell you something right now. There's a hatred of fundamental Bible-believing people by the Church of America that's apostate. There is a hatred of people that believe the authorized version is the Bible. I mean, they disdain us, they mock us, they scorn us. We are messing up their little religious party. That's the problem. But anyway, in verse 35, he said, "That upon you, upon that generation, may come all the righteous blood shed upon the earth, from the blood of righteous Abel," that goes back to Genesis, the first martyr, "to the blood of Zacharias, of Berechias, whom ye slew between the temple and the altar." Think about this. The last prophet that was killed, that's in 2 Chronicles chapter 24. In the Hebrew Old Testament, their books are it's the same, but their books are arranged different. 2 Chronicles is your last book in the Old Testament in the Jewish layout of the Bible. And there's a reason God changed that for us. You can look at the Old Testament and see the last word, it'll tell you about it. But anyway, anybody know what the last word in the Old Testament is? Curse. There's a reason for that. We're cursed. We need a Savior. Here you come, Matthew. We're cursed. But anyway, the Jewish Bible, the Zacharias there, it says from Abel to Zacharias, he was a priest. And you ought to read the message in 2 Chronicles 24 that he preached to Israel. And he told them, he said, "God's going to punish you. He's going to take you into captivity. He's going to close this thing down. You're going into captivity because you will not repent and you will not obey God and you've rejected God." And you know what they did with him? They killed him. And where they killed him? Between the temple and the altar. Do you know what I'm talking about? Between the door of the temple and the altar. They killed that man of God for telling them the truth. That's where we're coming to in the latter days. Now, so you have this that Jesus is telling them about it. So he says there, watch what he says. "Verily I say to you, all these things shall come upon this generation," the generation to which he was speaking. Now let's go ahead. Look what he says in verse 37. "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how oft would I have gathered thee together, thy children together, even as the hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and you would not." Now here's this desolation I preached on last night. "Behold, your house, your temple, your worship system is left desolate. It's dead. Go back to the fig tree. Leaves, but no fruit." He cursed it and it died. And he said, "Bear no fruit from henceforth forever as a fig tree." And Israel will never bear anything. They're dead as rocks. You want to talk about dead religion. You know what they're using for a sacrifice, if they use anything? A chicken. And they'll sling a chicken around like this. And God never told them to, well, he did say fowl in there, but you know, they don't do the lamb, they don't do the bullocks, or none of that. I mean, it's just, somebody preached here this week, a bloodless religion. Where's the blood? And so he said, "I would have gathered you, but you would not. He left your house desolate. For I say unto you, Israel, ye shall not see me henceforth, till ye shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord." Now, the Ichabod is going to happen right here when you shift from chapter 23 to 24. Watch what he does. And Jesus went out and did what? Departed from where? That's exactly what happened in the Old Testament. What does that tell you about the glory that I preached the other night? Jesus Christ is the glory. And when Christ leaves out of a ministry, leaves out of a church, leaves a nation, a family, Ichabod is written upon them and the glory of God has departed. Now, he's going to tell you now what's going to happen as a result of his departure, what could have been, but what could not be now because of that. And he went out of the temple, and his disciples came to him to show him the buildings of the temple. Isn't that like us? Now, you know, we put new carpeting up here. But you know something? I don't think God's up in heaven going, oh, man, I'm going to let them folks have a great service next Sunday. They got new carpet. You know, I think we'll take care of God's house, but that's not it. It's right here. Now, they were all about that temple. Beautiful, beautiful temple. And they just had, man, I mean, people are still, stained glass windows. Oh, my land, you know, and, oh, it's just on and on. That's why, how many picked up, I'm not too wild about building stuff. You're going to build it cheap as you can, good as you can, let's go on down the road. Because it's all going to burn. Anyway, Jesus said unto them, see you not these things? Verily I say, there shall not be left here, this temple, one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And then he says in verse 33, as he said upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of the coming and of the end of the world? And of course, we talked about the sign because he told them later in the chapter what the sign would be. Now, in chapter 24, Jesus Christ showed them 40 years in advance prophecy what was going to happen in that temple. In AD 70, Titus, a Roman general, surrounded, and boy, you can literally read almost a daily diary account of this. When they brought the armies in, they surrounded the nation, the city of Jerusalem, put them under siege, and it was terrible. It was horrible. They starved them out, and before it's all done, there were over 1 million Jewish people slaughtered when they broke through finally. By the way, you can watch, they've even got 3D deals now of how they broke through each section of the wall and how many days it took to get to finally wipe them out. But that was 30 years later. Titus surrounded the city. Romans slaughtered them, killed them, and they carried those Jews into captivity, and they were dispersed to the ends of the world. There were so many Jewish slaves for sale that they couldn't even get people to give a bid for a Jewish girl. That's how cheap slaves got to be. And by the way, that was prophesied by the prophecies. You go back, you'll read the prophets. They prophesied that about the daughters of Israel in their rejection of God. There were black crosses on the hills surrounding Jerusalem. The slave market was glutted. The hanging Jews on the cross, they covered them with black pitch when they put them on the cross and lighted them up to make light for the Roman possessions of their chariots and their people. In chapter 24, 1 and 2, there we read, it talks about this generation. That was a literal generation of which he was speaking. There are many foreshadows of Israel in history in the Old Testament. Job is a picture of Israel going through the great tribulation. Jacob, the time of Jacob's trouble in the Old Testament is a 7-year period, and it is divided into two sections. If you read Matthew chapter 24, actually, if you want to just look there, if you look in verse number 21, he gives you the first half of the tribulation. Then he tells you about the last half. In verse 1, then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, nor shall ever be. Now, so we have Israel. Job, how many chapters in Job? 42 chapters. That's 3.5. 3.5 years is 42 months. All right? There was the terrible persecution and the loss that he did. And he didn't see Christ till the end of the book. And that's the way it's going to be for Israel. Jacob's life. Jacob was born. Jacob was sent out and dispersed. Jacob comes back. He's a picture of Israel. Samson's life is a picture of Israel. Noah is a double type. Noah and his family are a picture of Israel going through the tribulation. Okay? Being taken through the wrath of God. And so Israel, but here's what I want to tell you. Israel was promised something. They were promised the land through Isaac's seed repeatedly, this land of Israel that we're talking about. Israel has an eternal covenant relationship with God. Let me back up and just say something, why this is important. How many noticed I got wound up when Brother Crum was preaching today? Did you notice me get wound up a little bit? Let me tell you why I got wound up. Because he preached about a literal promises of God. Don't spiritualize them. Don't symbolize them. They mean what they say. And he was preaching on this literalness of this whole thing. Here's what happened. Before World War I, most churches in America were preaching amillennialism or postmillennialism. And here's what they thought. America was founded, of course, back there in the 1700s, comes up, and man, we had the Industrial Revolution, and the medicine and industry and the way standard of living going up. And they got in their head now this theology. And by the way, it came out of Catholicism that God was done with Israel forever. I've had preachers look at me like they could kill me and tell me, Kelly, you're as wrong as you can be. God is forever done with Israel, and and the church has replaced Israel. Now I'm going to tell you something. You will never get your theology right until you get clear about something. That Israel is Israel, and the church is the church, and they are not the same, and God doesn't have the same program for them. What got America into trouble and got a lot of people in trouble is church claiming the promises that God gave to Israel and thinking that God was speaking to the church when he was speaking to the Jewish people. And you start misapplying, you're not rightly dividing the word of truth, it'll get you in all kinds of trouble, and it'll just be a complex, and you won't know what's going on. So in the turn of the century, now watch this, we started out 1880 with our new Bibles. It was about the first time the new Bible left the King James Bible in this country. Around the turn of the century, it got worse. And I'm going to say a little something. God started backing up from America. God still wanted to bless us. God still wanted to honor us. But we did something that God didn't like, and that was we messed with his word. Then what they were saying was, and here's what they were saying. They were saying, we are going, watch this, the church replaced Israel is going to make the world so wonderful, and we're going to cure crime and hatred, and we're going to create a utopia. This is where your socialism mindset comes from. It's where your communistic mindset comes from. It's what your Democrat Party is being totally built upon, is creating a utopia. And they know that you and I stand in the way of that because we do not believe that. We believe that we are wicked and sinners, and that a Savior is going to come back and that he died on the cross. You see, when you tell a socialist Democrat that Jesus died on the cross for him, he doesn't like that. You know why? Because you're telling him he's a sinner and he can't save himself and he needs a Savior. You're insulting him to the core of his soul. You're insulting him to about, I mean, listen, I'm telling you, the last 2 weeks, I have never had such statements. You're the problem with America. When we get rid of you fundamentalists, when we get rid of you Bible believers, then we can have a great nation. Not with you people. They hate us because our very belief system tells them they are wicked to the core and they need a Savior and that they're not setting up no kingdom. But your churches preached that they was going to bring in the kingdom, and then at the end of that, Jesus could come back and reign on it after we got it all fixed. And that's what most churches in early 19th century was preaching. They had a little problem come up. It's called World War I. And the world exploded into war, and there were people butchered and slaughtered like hogs all over Europe. And boy, they scratched their head and they said, we're not doing it. But maybe, and by the way, remember Woodrow Wilson? He is one of those people. He said, this is the war to end all wars. And 20 years later, we was in another war. And what happened was, by the time World War II got over, you couldn't hardly find a post-millennial preacher because they'd all run back in their rabbit hole. They said, it ain't working like we thought. The church is going to bring in the kingdom. We're so righteous and so good and so holy and such nice people. We don't need Jesus Christ to come back here and straighten this thing up. Jesus, you sit up there and wait on us. We're going to fix this thing down here. That's totally opposite of what the Bible teaches. Another thing about it is they don't want him. The truth about it is they wanted Jesus that kind of was out there somewhere. And they're going to be their own God. They're going to say what's right, what's wrong. You see, right now, I mean, see, they look at us. If you say you don't believe in transgenderism, same-sex marriage, and all that trash, they think you're wicked. They think you're sinful by not being tolerant. That's right. Yeah, that's right. They believe you're wicked. That's why they're getting mad at you. They think you are the filth of the earth because you're not tolerant of anything they want to do, tolerant of their sin. Well, listen to these verses. If we'd have believed our Bible, we'd have known better than that, because it got us into a lot of trouble. Jeremiah 30:11 says, God said, though I make a full end, watch this, listen, of all nations, to which I have scattered these, unto the Jewish people, he said, though I make a full end of all nations where I've scattered you, yet will I not make a full end of thee. Now, what's God saying? I'm going to destroy every nation on the globe except you. By the time this thing's over. Can I tell you something that means the United States of America, our nation? How many knows we deserve destruction right now? We deserve destruction. But I'm going to tell you, if you want to know about anything about America in the Bible, right there it is. God says, He said, I'm going to make a full end of all nations. But he said, I'm not going to make a full end with Israel. Israel is an eternal nation of people, the Hebrew people. Jeremiah 31:36 says, thus saith the Lord, who giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinances of the moon and the stars by light by night, which divideth the sea with its waves, when its waves roar. The Lord of hosts is his name. And then God says something to Israel. If these ordinances depart from before me, in other words, if the sun quit shining and the oceans quit roaring, he said, then the seed of Israel also shall cease from being a nation before me. In other words, he's saying there will never be a time when Israel is not a nation. All right? Now I'm laying this foundation for where we're headed to. Israel is an eternal nation with an eternal covenant with God Almighty. The Jew has stood on top of the grave of every nation that persecuted him. You ever heard of a country named Spain? Spain at one time was a world power. Did you know that? In 1492, Columbus sailed. Where was he from? Spain was sending people around the globe. They were a world power. But they made a mistake. They didn't believe Genesis chapter 12, where God told, he said, I will, by Abraham and his seed, I will bless those that bless thee, and I will curse those that curse thee. Israel had, Spain did something called the Inquisition. And in the Inquisition, there's something called the Bartholomew Massacre. And that was, they sent their Spanish troops out one night and arrested all the Jews in the land, drug them out in the streets, cut their throats, cut their guts open, drug their bodies with horses through the streets of Spain, and slaughtered the Jews like you'd slaughter a pack of hogs. And Christians were also killed in that. And then they put out an edict in Spain that the Jews were expelled from the land. You know what God did with Spain? He made them a nobody nothing. They've been a nobody nothing ever since. They couldn't whip their way out of a wet paper bag. Because why? Because they affronted and cursed God's people. And God said, I'll curse you. Now I'm giving you some proof historically. The Jew has stood on the grave of every persecutor they've ever had. The overall work and plan of God on earth, apart and outside of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, is around and about the nation of Israel. And without an biblical understanding of the nation of Israel, we're not going to understand the second coming of Jesus Christ. The spiritual significance of the rebirth of Israel tonight, the leaves of the parable of the parable of the fig tree. And so we have this handout here. There's three trees that symbolize Israel in history, and I've given them to you a while ago. The vine, it represents Israel in the Old Testament. You can find that in Isaiah chapter 5, verses 1 through 7, Matthew 21, Psalms chapter 80. And it represents them from Egypt to Calvary. They were a vine. Then they represent an olive tree in Romans chapter 11. And I'm not going to go through all these scriptures tonight just for time's sake, but God literally tells you in the book of Romans chapter 11 that Israel has been cut off, and you and I were grafted in, Gentiles were grafted in, and that we've been made partaker of the fatness of Israel and the blessing of God on the nation Israel. But he said there's going to come a time when the church is going to be taken out and they'll be regrafted into their original root. And that's what's going to happen when the Lord Jesus comes back. Now, it's been 2,000 years. God hadn't said anything to a Jew or a Hebrew. Do you know that? When they rejected the Lord Jesus Christ, when Jesus was rejected and went back to glory, he has not talked to the Jewish nation since. Now, he has been providentially fulfilling his prophecies about them. But there's also, let me tell you, that's the significance that most people don't have a clue about Acts chapter 2. They don't know nothing about it. It's a sad thing. All they know is that somebody thinks they're supposed to speak in tongues because something about Acts chapter 2. It tells you clearly that they spoke in 19 different tongues, and it says languages even. It was a Feast of Pentecost. They brought them in there. They were from all these different nations that they had been dispersed to. They came in to celebrate the feast. God gave a supernatural, prophetically out of the book of Joel and other places, that they would be able to supernaturally speak in a language of other people. And what this was about was launching the gospel of Jesus Christ to carry that into the rest of the world. But if you go back and study this issue that was prophesied about Acts chapter 2, you'll find out that tongues was a sign of judgment on the nation of Israel for rejecting God. And he said, you've rejected him. I'm taking the gospel to the Gentiles. And the apostle Paul took off, and you ain't never got over it. Amen. Now, so the Hebrews are here. Now, I want you to get this. Because they rejected him, they are out of spiritual privilege. This is a big deal. This is a big deal. Because I'm going to read you something pretty soon about Jewish people that'll show you this. When they rejected him, God cut them off, just like he talked about in Romans 11, from what is called, in basic terms, spiritual privilege. And God gave spiritual privilege to the church now. The church is the one proclaiming the Lord Jesus Christ, not Israel. Israel, Jewish people, by and large, are fighting the gospel of Jesus Christ. You and I are in a position of spiritual privilege, but the church right now is about right in here, and we are in an apostate position. We are departing from the Lord Jesus Christ, from his word, and we're in apostasy, all right? And we're fixing to have spiritual privilege taken away from us. And in the tribulation period, there'll be 144,000 Jewish evangelists that are going to have spiritual privilege given back to them. And they're going to tear this world up for Jesus. You just watch what I tell you. So anyway, we said in AD 70, they were dispersed and scattered and buried in the nations. And Matthew chapter 24 talks about that. And then the return of Christ. He's answering that question. And he talks about the cursing of that tree right there. So what do we see? The fig tree, Israel, in the latter days is going to be regathered in the land in unbelief. And that's exactly what happened. The Jewish people are back in the land, but they're in unbelief. Did you know it's illegal in Israel to basically go out and evangelize? You can't do in Israel what I'm doing tonight. Do it legally. It's probably done some, but you can't. That's how much they don't want Jesus Christ involved in their life. Now, think if Israel, the fig tree, had not been regathered in the land, in unbelief, Jesus would be a false prophet. Now, this is important. Israel was gathered back into the land late 1800s and still happening. If that hadn't happened, the prophecies of Jesus Christ about them coming back, it would make him out to be a false prophet. So there's three things I want to give you. We'll try to be done here tonight. Number one, Israel is a great mystery. Great mystery. They're a mystery. And here's why. They have resisted assimilation. Assimilation means that my forefathers, one side of them came from Germany, another side came from Ireland, and who knows what's between. How many's ever seen that guy, Norman Rockwell's little vine deal? He shows all these people in your family tree, and horse thieves and bank robbers and all that kind of stuff. That's my family tree. Did you know what? I am an assimilated American. I don't go around saying I'm an Irish American or an American Irish. I don't go around saying, I just say I'm an American. Why? I'm assimilated. Assimilation is very important for the strength of a nation. That's why we're trying to have people separate us here and divide us and class warfare in this country. Our forefathers knew the power of assimilation. Doesn't mean we agree with about everything, but we're Americans and we're going to stand together and we have basic common things. But that's being destroyed because of our walk away from God. Now, So it's a, if you lose your roots in Nashville, I don't know, honest to goodness, I don't know my ancestors who came over here. I just know a little bit about their ethnicity and where they're from. But when you talk about things, somebody may say, well, I'm an Irish American, or somebody may say I'm a German American or a French American or an English American. But Jews don't think that way. Jews are always a Jew. It doesn't make any difference where they're at. And by the way, they're in every nation under heaven, just like God said they would be. They do not say, I'm a Jewish American. They say, I'm an American Jew. Or I'm a Canadian Jew. Or I'm a Soviet Jew. Or I'm a Bolivian Jew. They don't, it's totally different than any other people group on the face of this earth. Now, the Jew is a Jew always and everywhere forever. Now, I realize there are Jewish people that are mixed with Gentiles and so forth and half Jew and three-quarter Jew and all that. But as a general principle, they maintain their heritage. Jesus said the Jews would be scattered to every nation in the world, uprooted, torn from their families, yet they would maintain their distinctiveness as a Jew. Listen to me. That has been 60 generations ago. They've been without land, without a land, without a flag. They were without a language. But the mystery is they resisted assimilation. They did not assimilate like any other nation or people groups do down through history. They're a great mystery. They're not only a great mystery because they've never been assimilated, because God said in his word they would be an eternal nation. They're secondly a great miracle. Why are they a great miracle? I can't think of the man. He was a real high up guy in England, back in one of the kings. And the king asked him, he said, he was trying to influence the king biblically. And he said, I don't have confidence in the Bible. He said, in one word, tell me why I should believe the Bible. And that man said, Jew. And he's right. Because if you study their history out, you'll find this Bible is absolutely in super detail, exactly right. Amen. Everything about them. They've resisted extermination. Now, this is a miracle, and I'll tell you why. What is the history of the Jewish people? Continuous persecution and murder, extermination and death. From the time that they were formed as a nation in Egypt, what did Pharaoh want to do to the Jewish people? Kill all the baby boys, destroy the seed, and ultimately destroy the nation. By the way, let's just look at this seed thing. There was a promise in Genesis 3:15. Why would Satan, why would this world want to destroy the Jewish people back then? It carried the Messiah. If you could kill all the Jews, why did Hitler talk about the final solution to kill every Jew? Every Jew. Because if you were able to kill every Jew, you would not have a Messiah. That's just a literal fact. Herod, you come from Moses up to Herod. What did Herod do? Killing all the baby boys. There's always been an attack to exterminate the Jewish people, and it's been backed by satanic power, Satan himself. In Rome and in Babylon and Persia, the Jewish people have been persecuted nonstop. The Nazis in the Holocaust, if you've never been to Yad Vashem Museum, there's one up here in St. Louis, you ought to go to it. But over 1 million Jewish people, Jewish children, babies and children, were marched into gas chambers and killed. Why did they kill the kids for? They're trying to exterminate their seed. Over 6 million Jews were killed by Hitler during that. A lot of people won't talk about what Stalin did and Lenin did, but they killed just as many or more people. In fact, they killed 20 million compared to Stalin's, to Hitler's 6 million. The Nazi Holocaust with its trains and its ovens. It's killing camps. Then Russia had the pogroms. If you've ever watched Fiddler on the Roof, that's a historic, it has an undercurrent story to it. It's about the persecution and the driving out of the Jewish people out of Russia. You get down to Hitler, what did he do? Night of crystal glass. Start killing the Jews. They had a plan to exterminate every Jew in Europe. Where did that come from? It came from Satan. But the Jews have a supernatural power upon them that they are not going to be exterminated, because God Almighty said in the Old Testament that they would be an eternal people. During the Dark Ages, the Crusaders, you know what they would do? They killed entire cities of Jewish people, wiped them out, man, woman, and child. It killed them. That's why Jews to this day have a bad viewpoint of Christianity. Because when a Jew hears Christian, his forefathers have taught him that's the Crusaders who walked in and slit our throats and wiped out our entire towns. When they think of Christian, they don't see you and I as people who love Israel and love the Lord Jesus Christ and the gospel of Jesus Christ. They see it as Crusaders to kill. By the way, a lot of your public school people will tell you that Christianity is taught in their schools. No, no. What they're teaching in the schools, and I know this for a fact because I've looked at their textbooks, they're teaching the Crusades, which is not Christianity. By the way, that perpetuates the war between Muslims and Christians. The Dark Ages, the Crusades, whole cities killed. It's been one long, terrible, torturous history of persecution and death of Jews fearing the knock on the door, fearing the steps in the hallway, listening for boots in the street, being chased from one nation to another. But I want you to remember they said something when Jesus was being crucified. And he's had this up here well. You know what the Jewish people said to Herod or to Pilate? His blood be upon us and our children. They didn't know what they were saying. Century after century, Jewish families have gathered together, though, at what they call Passover, celebrating that which goes back to the time of Moses. And at the close of it, they say these words. Next year in Jerusalem. Why do they say that? Because those believing Jews believe the promises of God about a Messiah that will come back someday and rule the earth, and he will reign in Jerusalem, and they see that as the land that's given to them. I want you to go to Ezekiel chapter 37 tonight. Ezekiel chapter 37, and we're going to look at the I'll give you another type of Israel in the Bible. Moses was out there 40 years in the wilderness, and one day he's walking out, and guess what he sees? Anybody know what he sees? A burning bush. That burning bush was a picture of Israel. Ever burning, but never consumed. Israel is burning under persecution, has forever. And by the way, can I tell you, right here in the Ozarks, there is a large element of people who hate Jews. I want to say from this pulpit publicly, and I hope all of Norwood's hearing this. We love the Jewish people. God has, they are God's chosen people. They are the apple of his eye. And he said, whoever touches the apple of his eye, you're going to get in trouble. Anybody listen to me, you need to get off of that garbage of hating Jewish people. We're going to talk about some Jewish people. We're going to talk about some problems that we have with them. But that doesn't mean we should hate them or destroy them. But as I said, in Ezekiel chapter 37, we'll look at this passage real quick here. Let's go to verse number 1, chapter 7. The hand of the Lord is upon me and carried me out in the Spirit of the Lord. This is a prophecy by God gave Ezekiel. Set me down in the midst of the valley which is full of bones. Caused me to pass by them round about. And behold, there were very many in the open valley. And lo, they were very dry. You ain't never seen anything as dry as a religious Jew. And he said to me, son of man, can these bones live? And he answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. And he said unto me, prophesy thou upon these bones. And say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and ye shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and bring up flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and ye shall live. And you shall know that I am the Lord. This is a prophecy about Israel. It's going to tell you that pretty soon. Verse 7. So I prophesied as I was commanded. As I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking. And the bones came together, bone to his bone. And when I behold, lo, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them above. But there was no breath in them. That's where they're at right now in prophetic history. Verse 9. Then he said unto me, prophesy in the wind. Wind's a picture of the Holy Ghost. Prophesy, son of man, save the wind. Thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, breathe upon these slain that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into me, and they lived and stood upon their feet in the exceeding great army. Now look at him. You don't have to interpret this. You don't have to wonder about this. Look at verse number 11. Then he said unto me, son of man, these bones, now I want you to hang your hat right here for a minute, are the whole, circle that, the whole house of Israel. A lot of these people that are anti-Israel talk about 10 lost tribes. There is not 10 lost tribes. God ain't lost old Jews. He knows where every one of them's at. There's not 10 lost tribes. That's a bunch of garbage that somebody dreamed up about the 10 northern tribes going up to the Caucasian Mountains, winding up across and over the English Channel into England and coming over here to America. And they believe, and that's where you get your white Aryan nation stuff. That's where you get this tribe of Judah stuff you see on the back of their jackets. That's where you get your Hebrew black Hebrew deals up there in Washington, D.C. that march around. Claiming they're Jews. They're not, the Bible talks about people who claim they're Jews and are not. Don't ever do that. Amen. Now, if you're a Jew, great. And I'm glad for you and we love you. But I'm a Gentile and I ain't going to claim to be a Jew. Amen. I am a spiritual Jew in the sense of spiritual faith of Father Abraham. But I'm not a blood Jew. And there is not 10 lost tribes. I won't say that again. To the world, there is not 10 lost tribes. God knows where they're all at. Amen. He said, these bones of the whole house of Israel, behold, they say our bones are dried and hope is lost. We're cut off for our parts. Therefore prophesy and say, and then thus saith the Lord God, behold my people, watch this, I will open your graves, cause you to come up out of your graves, and bring you into the land of Egypt. They were buried in the nations of the world in their dispersion. God says, and you're dry, your bone, you're spiritually dead. I'm going to bring those bones together, put flesh and sin you on them. I'm going to make you get up, walk. I'm going to bring you back to the land, but I'm not going to put wind in you yet, but I'm going to bring you. And that's exactly where we're at in the prophecy of the word of God. And you shall know that I'm the Lord God, when you've opened your graves, your people, and brought you up out of your graves. Now comes to verse 14. This is when Christ comes back. This is when the Jewish people see the Lord. Every eye shall see him. And I'll put my spirit in you, and you shall live, and I shall place you where? In your own land. That land does not belong to the Palestinians. Not one Muslim has a right to that land over there. Not one Arab has a right to land. Not one American has a right to that land. It's God's people's land. But anyway, he's going to tell you down there in verse 16, up through there, you can read that in your own time. He's going to take this two sticks together, the southern tribes and the northern tribes, bring together, make one house out of them there, all right? Now, so we said it's a great miracle that they've not been exterminated. That burning bush burnt, but was not consumed. The Jewish nation has been burnt with persecution, but has not been consumed. Now I'm going to give you a little historic overview of the rebirth of the modern nation of Israel. Theodor Herzl was a Budapest Jew who in 1897 founded what is known as the Zionist movement. That came as a result of him witnessing anti-Semitism, and especially that of Alfred Dreyfus, the case he had in France. And he heard those crowds chanting in France, death to the Jews, death to the Jews, death to the Jews. And so he realized that the Jewish people needed a homeland. If you want to write these scriptures down tonight, I'm going to give them to you, and I'm not going to go to them because of time's sake. But there's 9 scriptures I'm going to give you references if you want to write them down. Isaiah chapter 11, verses 11 and 12 and verse 15. That's Isaiah 11 and 12 and verse 15. The second one is Isaiah 43, verse 5 and 6. I wish I had time. If we was at church, we'd have the guys putting them on the screen. We'd keep rolling, but I just can't for time's sake tonight. The third one is Isaiah 60, verses 8 through 10. The fourth one is Jeremiah 16, verses 14 through 16. Jeremiah 16, verses 14 through 16. And then the next was Jeremiah 23, verse 3. Jeremiah 23, verse 3. The sixth one is Jeremiah 29, 14. Jeremiah 29, 14. So that's the first six. Now the last three are all in Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 11, verses 17 through 19. Ezekiel 34, 11 through 24. Ezekiel 34, 11 through 24, and Ezekiel 37, verses 11 through 14. Does anybody need me to go through those? You can listen to the tape again, all right? Now, there's a reason I gave those references to you. I'm not reading them because of time's sake, but he tells explicitly that Israel's going to be reborn and they're going to be brought back into the land. He says it 9 times in those passages. He means it. He's not joking. Now, Theodor Herzl, was not a believing Jew. He was an agnostic, almost basically atheistic, for sure a humanistic Jew. He did not believe the Bible. He had left Judaism as far as they go, but he still identified himself as a Jew. His Zionist drive was motivated not by spiritual knowledge of the Bible, but by a sovereign act of God, that God just moved on him to start to have a homeland for the Jewish people. Theodore Herzl did not even seem to know that he was fulfilling prophecy of Almighty God. It was like God just sovereignly and prophetically raised this man up, an unbeliever, and he was accomplishing the prophecies of the Old Testament and not even aware that he was doing it. Here's what I want to get to you tonight. God is moving tonight, and we don't see it till it's passed. I promise you, the deal about Trump, there's something weird about this. The deal about the election situation, all the stuff that's going on, I promise you, God is orchestrating, bringing to pass his prophecies and bringing to pass his providential will for the last time, for the second coming of Jesus Christ. I promise you, but we never see it till it's passed. We look back and say, you know what? I can see that now, but we never see it in advance. So he was fulfilling the word of God, even though he was not a believer per se. At that time, now listen, if the land of Israel was under the control of the Ottoman Turks, which is a Muslim people, okay? They controlled that land. There were still Jews in there, and there's been Jews in there for ever since time. World War I breaks out. England, now watch this. England conquered the Ottoman Turks in World War I. They drove them out of the land of Israel. And there's a man by the name of, he's a British general by the name of Allenby. He liberated Israel from the Muslims, the Ottoman Turks. And I want you to get something. When he came into Jerusalem and to the Delavisa, the trail of blood to the cross, this is historic. You can literally see clips of film on this. He got off of his white horse, General Allenby did, and said, I will not ride my horse where my Savior carried his cross. That's the kind of people England had back in 1917. Generals who saw the prophetic picture because of their knowledge of the scripture. Did you ever realize that England is just a little bitty island off the coast of Europe? And yet they sent missionaries and Bibles into the entire world. The Bible that you're holding in your lap tonight was written under the authorization of King James. He didn't translate a word of it. It doesn't mean, I don't care if he was a godless whatever. He had nothing to do with it other than the fact that he approved and allowed through God-ordained authority for that to be done. Don't let these clowns out here tell you stuff about King James. He was the king who authorized it to be done. He did not translate it. And so understand that. But anyway, England conquered those men. General Allenby come in there. And he conquered Palestine. So now that became what's known as the British Mandate. Now watch history move and the prophecy being fulfilled. God, it's called the British Mandate. It's under British control. Now, why would it be under British control? There was a Jewish chemist by the name of Chaim Weizmann that during World War I developed artificial gunpowder. First time in history. And without it, Britain would not have won World War I. It was a Jewish chemist that developed it, got it to the British government. They were able to win that war when actually most people thought that Germany was going to win the first war. But a Jewish chemist came up with that and gave it to the British. So they asked him, Lord Balfour, at that time in England, an official of the British government, asked Weizmann, Chaim Weizmann, to name what he would love, what he would like, so the nation could reward him for what he did for England. Here's what Chaim Weizmann said. He said, I request a homeland for the Jewish people. At that point in time, Israel was in control of the land of Israel. He knew they had the authority and the power to do it. Balfour then wrote how it's called the Balfour Declaration, which said that Britain looks with favor upon the establishment of a homeland for the Jewish people. Now, if you go back again to Jeremiah, Isaiah, Ezekiel, and what God said was going to happen, what you're seeing in my lifetime and in our parents' lifetime, God was moving providentially through the leaders of this world, put the Muslims out, brought England in, mandate, a Jewish chemist comes in. He's got that. They say, what can we do for you? He says, a national homeland. And they declare their favor to do that. And then later on in 1947, the United Nations, after World War II, voted to petition Palestine and gave Israel just a little piece of what God has for them in the end. Now, so what happened? Well, the Arabs, they erupted in violence, and Jews began to come back in the land. And by the way, did you know this? That when the Jews first started going back in the land, fulfilling the prophecy of God, bringing them in from the north, east, south, the west, bringing them from all over the world and putting them in land, that the Jewish people bought back all their own land. That the Rothschild Foundation, who is a super rich Jewish family with holdings all over the world, put the money up for them to go in and buy that land from people so they couldn't claim that they stole it. But then Hitler comes to power in the 30s there. Let's go back up a little bit. And he persecutes the Jews and slaughters them. And they try to flee to Israel. Now, I want you to watch this carefully. And I want you to think about America tonight. I want to tell you this. Arab nations at that time persuaded England to issue what's called in history the White Papers. They started off saying, we look with favor upon the reestablishment of a homeland for the Jewish people. England had ships all over the world and colonies all over the world. They're world power. They lived on oil, Arab oil. The Arabs said, if you let those Jews back in there, you may have control of that land now, but if you let them back in there, we're going to cut off the oil to you. Did you know what England done? You listen to this. England flipped. And they bowed down to the Arab oil cartels. And they rejected and made hard for the Jewish people to come back. In fact, so much so that when they ended the British mandate, the British government handed over all the ammunition and all the strongholds and all the important places, strategic locations, to the Arabs. Now, let me tell you what happened to England after that. England, at that point, the sun never set on English soil. But they cursed whom God said don't curse. And you know what happened by the time World War II was over? England was a bankrupt nation who, had it not been for the United States of America, would have been whipped by Hitler. And they lost all their colonies. And where the sun used to never set on British soil, all they wound up being is a bankrupt nation outside the coast of Europe. I'm telling you, don't touch the Jewish people. God cursed England, and they suffered for it. World War II is over. The Holocaust has been revealed to the world, what Hitler did to the Jewish people. And the United Nations partitioned Palestine, and it was given on the May 14th, 1948. David Ben-Gurion, the first president of Israel, declared statehood. The British troops started withdrawing, and as they withdrew from the land, they gave the places to the Muslim people, and they had what's called the War of Independence. And miraculously, that handful of Jewish people defeated all those Muslim people. And that's a miracle of God. It shouldn't have happened. They're surrounded today by 300 million Muslims. There's no way they should have had that victory on that. Now, I'm going to give you a side story about all this. It's very, very interesting. And to show you that in our country, United States of America, God has been and is working in a providential way toward the second coming of Jesus Christ. And in the hand of God, regathering Israel back. During all those years that I've talked about, there was a young man by the name of Harry Truman, born in Missouri, over here, Lamar, Missouri area. And Harry Truman tried to make it farming. He learned what all of us know. You got to have, my dad always said, if I had $1 million, I'd farm till it's all gone. And you better have good business if you're going to farm. Amen? So he failed in farming, and he went broke, Harry Truman did, and he moved to Kansas City, Missouri. Listen to me carefully. He went into a men's clothing business up there in Kansas City, Missouri, with a man by the name of Eddie Jacobson. And Harry and Eddie tried to do the best they could, but they went broke selling men's clothing store, and they went broke. So Truman wound up entering into local Kansas City politics. And Truman wound up being a good yes man to the Pendergrass political machine in Kansas City, Missouri, which, by the way, is one of the most wicked, devilish political institutions ever been in America. It matches all of them up in New York. Over time, as he went up through the political ranks up here in Kansas City, a Senate seat come open, and Pendergrass, who was running the Democrat Party here in Missouri, selected Harry Truman to run for Senate. And he, of course, won here in Missouri. It was a Democrat state at that time. And Pendergrass told Harry Truman, he said, "You go to Washington, D.C., and you vote the way I tell you to without exception. You do what I tell you to every time." "Yes, sir." And he headed. That's what happens when you buy politicians. But I'm going to tell you something tonight. The hand of our sovereign God is above politicians buying people. His wife seldom seen him. Bess wouldn't go to Washington, D.C. She didn't like it. She wouldn't go. So Harry's up there all by himself most of the time. So you know what he does? He starts studying all the reports of the agencies of the military during that time. He finds out during World War II that there's a contractor's ripping the American government off bad. Can you imagine such a thing? I never thought of that happening in this country. I can't imagine it happening. And what he did was he went and visited all over the United States plants and production things, war production, and he wrote a report about it. It's a very famous thing that happened in America. He came back, gave the report to Congress, and he did, it made himself useful. So here's what happened. He rose up the ranks and he became famous because of this investigative report of the waste of taxpayers' money in America, contractors. He was on the Senate committee investigation, and he saved American taxpayers millions of dollars. Well, he gained national attention because of that. And through that, Harry was able to shake off the control and the grip that Pendergrass had on him up here at Kansas City. He didn't have to listen to him anymore. The 1944 election comes up. FDR is running for his fourth term. The liberal and conservative Democrats, if you can believe it, there were conservative Democrats at that time, lots of them. They actually controlled a lot of the party. They were fighting over the vice presidential nomination. FDR had a man by the name of Wallace who was his vice president, elected in 1940. Wallace was a communist. He was a socialist. He was a mystic. I've read his own writings about his beliefs about mystic powers. He went to Russia, took a trip to Russia, came back, gave American people glowing reports of collectivism, of the government owning everything that you have. By the way, do you know what his family owns today? Pioneer Hybrid Seed Company, Corn Seed Company. He was a very rich man. That's how he got where he got, by giving money to Roosevelt in the first election. That's how he got appointed. He worked himself up as Vice President of the United States of America. When the convention came there for the 44 election, the conservatives knew that Roosevelt would never live through another term and whoever was vice president would be president. And they absolutely did not want this man Wallace to be. And they threw an absolute fit and worked through the night after night at the convention. And they finally defeated him. But the way they defeated Wallace and got him knocked off the ticket was by taking in a compromised candidate that both could agree on, conservative liberal, whose name was Harry Truman, because everybody liked Harry because he saved American taxpayers lots of money. So Harry Truman, all of a sudden, out of the blue, from nowhere, as a broke farmer in Missouri, is vice president of the United States of America. And he finds out, he can hear him say this, a vice president's job is not worth spit. That's what Harry Truman said. You do a lot of nothing. You're worthless. There's no use for you. He said that. But here's what happened. How many knows that? They had no more got elected. And April of that year, 1945, Roosevelt died. And all of a sudden, Harry Truman was president of the United States of America in 1945. Remember, United Nations is fighting to get Israel to have a homeland. Okay? They're having all this debate and everything, having this discussion. Comes up 1947. And they get the petition voted, and Ben-Gurion declares the state, but here was the deal. It didn't amount to anything if the countries of the world didn't recognize them. And so men began to ask Harry Truman,
will you declare our support for Israel, that we recognize them as a nation? And Harry Truman had a lot of people in his cabinet left on FDR, and they were telling him, don't you dare do that. That country cannot survive. They'll be whipped by the Muslims. They're poor as a whipwheel. They won't amount to anything. There's nothing there. There's no spiritual relevance to it, nothing. And Harry Truman had determined that he would just sit back and not say anything and let that little baby embryo nation, Israel, die in its baby form. But one day, soon after that, a guy knocked on the desk of Harry Truman's presidential office. And the secretary came out and she said, can I help you? He said, I would like to see Mr. Truman, the president. Well, she said, who are you? And he said, would you just tell him that Eddie Jacobson is here? He'll know. She walked in, said, Mr. President, there's a guy says you know him well. He said, his name's Eddie Jacobson. He wants to talk to you. I can get rid of him if you want me to. He said, Eddie Jacobson, tell him to get his sorry hide in here. That's the way, if I said it like Truman said it, it wouldn't be not near that nice. Eddie Jacobson walks in. Truman jumps up his desk, walks around, shakes it, and says, Eddie, what are you doing here? Nobody comes here but what they want something. What do you want? Who was Eddie Jacobson? That was the man that he was in clothing business with and back in Kansas City before he ever entered into politics. Remember this. Do you know the name of that man? Say his name. Jacobson. He's a Jew. And he's even got the name Jacobson. Who was Jacobson? Jacob was named Israel in the 12 tribes of Israel. God even gave the man the name. Truman says, what do you want? He said, Chaim Weizmann has requested a meeting with you to recognize Israel, and you won't talk to him. And he said, Harry, all I'm asking you, would you just let him come in and talk to you about why we need a state of Israel? That's all I want. I don't want no money. I don't want no job. I don't want no position. I'm just asking you, hear him out. Harry Truman said, I'll catch blankety blank over this. And he said, don't bring him in the front door. He said, I'll have Secret Service. You have him pulled up to the back door. I'll have Secret Service there. I do not want the press even knowing he's here. And they did that. Harry Truman listened to Chaim Weizmann for a full day. You can watch. You can listen. They've got this recorded on live film. Harry Truman says, I listened. And the more I listened, I was rapt. I couldn't turn away from it. Let me tell you what was really going on. The sovereign God of heaven had made a way way back there before he ever knew he would need it for a man to give access to the before he even knew he was going to be president. And they met on a sovereign prophetic timetable. And he said, you come back tomorrow and I'm going to try to make a decision during the night. He came back the next day. He said, I want to hear more. He listened to him till about noon. He stood up. And Eddie was there, Chaim was there. He said, gentlemen, he said, I'm going to recognize the nation of Israel. And Harry Truman, you like him or not, but he was an instrument in the sovereign hand of Almighty God, got on national radio and made a declaration that the United States of America would put its full military power and support behind the nation of Israel. And Harry Truman contacted the Secretary of Defense and he said, you load up every plane we've got and you get everything over there they request. And we flew military supplies to Israel. And that's one of the reasons that they defeated those Muslim nations that had surrounded them. I'm going to tell you something. Did you know what happened after Harry Truman? God just moved Harry off the scene of history. He'd done with him. But America went through the most prosperous time in our history and the most peaceful time in our history, what's called the Eisenhower years. We were revered across the world. American people could get off a plane in any nation of this world and people would almost bow to you. They had such respect for this nation. God said, I will bless them that bless them. So that's a backstory on that. Let me go further and just say, we come on up through the years. They had a war in 1956. They won it. They had a war in 1967. You remember, probably remember the 67 war. In 1973, Dean, I think, had to go home. Dean was a soldier over in Germany at the 1973 Yom Kippur War. They had them sitting on the tarmac where the plane started, sat there overnight because we thought we were going to have to send troops in to rescue Israel. But let me tell you what happened. I'll give you just a little side story. I just want you to know something tonight. We're talking about camp meeting and you know, growing in the Lord and just resting in Christ and not worrying about the future. Hey, he's got it. He's got the whole world in his hands. In 1973, 67 was a six-day war. Israel whipped them people so fast, made their head swim. 73 on Yom Kippur with the Feast of the Atonement, okay, the atonement deal, the nation shuts down. All the nations attacked Israel on Yom Kippur in 1973, and they were killing them, beating them, destroying them, whipping them like nobody's business. And I'm telling you, Golda Meir, who was the prime minister, she literally told the cabinet, we're going to be defeated. We can't stop them. There's a guy that's not very popular in American history right now to a lot of people. His name is Richard Nixon. How many knows that Richard Nixon was raised as a Quaker? Richard Nixon's mother read her Bible. And Richard Nixon's mother would set him down on the chair, her lap, when he grew up and said, now, Richard, I want you to always remember something. God has a chosen people. It's Israel, the Jewish people. There's chosen people. And he's going to come back someday, and they're going to reclaim their land. And I don't know. He said, Richard, if you ever get a chance in life to help the Jewish people, you always help them because God blessed them and it blesses them. And in 1973, guess who was president? Richard Nixon. And guess what happened? The Yom Kippur War, and it looked like England, or looked like Israel was going to get wiped off the face of the earth. And you know what Richard Nixon did? He called his Secretary of Defense. And he said, I want every plane we've got. Because Meir called him. And she said, if you don't help us, it looks like we're out. And they loaded up massive, massive amounts of military planes, tanks, everything we had. We sent it. We had people in this government who tried to stop him. And he told his whole cabinet, get out of my way. And he told later in life, after he was impeached and put out of office, and asked, why did you help Israel? Listen to me, mamas, if you think you don't count. I had a mama who told me, if you ever get a chance to help Israel, son, be sure and help them. There's a sovereign God. And you may think there's little things going on that don't amount to anything. You don't have a clue. I promise you, God is moving time and history toward the second coming of his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. I know you're tired of probably hearing me blabbing. I love this stuff so much, I could just go on about it. But let me just tell you tonight, number one, the land belongs to Israel. God deeded to them. The fig tree is back in there. The tender branches are there, but they're in unbelief. But finally, let me say this to you and I'll close. There's a great message in there. They're no assimilation. Great. They're not going to be exterminated. But I'm going to tell you something about Israel. They're not going to be evacuated. This generation, the one who's going to witness the rebirth of Israel, that's our generation. Think of this. In the first generation of the church, okay, the church was side by side with Israel. That's a fact. Read the book of Acts. The church was side by side with Israel in the first generation. Guess what happened? Israel got taken out and the church got left in. They were dispersed. You and I are in the last generation. Guess what's going to happen? They're going to be left and we're going to be taken out at the rapture. That's right. I promise you, it's exactly what's going to happen. Israel is back in the land. They're carrying on their national functions. And the church age is about to close. You hear these guys getting preached on the rapture of the church? You better get your bags packed. Amen. We're heading out. Right. I'll just be honest with you. I know you say, well, I'll tell you what, my grandpa, you say that. Well, we're closer now than you was in your grandpa. And he's coming back. But there's a lot of things happening. And I'm telling you this, we learned the parable of the fig tree. What is it? Israel's back in the land. They've got leaves on. They can bear no fruit. And the next event that'll happen is Christ coming for the church. Tribulation period, Israel will be restored to spiritual privilege, be 144,000 Jewish evangelists going across the world to get gospel to the whole world. By the way, there's, how many know, does anybody know, I forgot something, I'm going to share this with you. Hey, if anybody needs to leave, okay, I'll see you in the morning, all right? I want you to listen to this list of people that you know, probably you know, are Jewish people. Jewish people are very, very small percentage of humanity. I mean, it's a little bitty, I don't even know if they're 1%. Of humanity, but they have an oversized influence. You ever heard of a guy named Albert Einstein? He's a Jew. You ever heard of Gloria Steinem? Planned Parenthood, feminist movement, she's a Jew. You ever heard of a guy named Jerry Lewis? He's a Jew. Elizabeth Taylor, she's a Jew. Ruth Ginsburg, she's a Jew. George Soros, he's a Jew. Harry Houdini, how many's heard of Harry Houdini? He was a Jew. Karl Marx, Leo Trotsky, the two communist buddies. Now I'm gonna say something here a little bit. Niels Bohr, he was the great physicist, all right? Sigmund Freud, stupidity, all right? Let me just stop and say something. I could name you 20 or 30 prominent Jewish people that you know real well in American history. And they were all bad. Most of them were bad for business. They were bad for Christianity. And there's a reason. Most of them are humanists and they don't believe in God, period. Okay? And they have a special hatred for Christianity as a general principle. By the way, Little House on the Prairie, what was his name? Michael Landon, he's a Jew. All right? David Ben-Gurion, Irvin Berlin, musician. Groucho Marx, Milton Friedman, Economicus, Keynesian economic plan. They affect every day of your life. They affect what you wear, what you eat, what you watch. They affect your life entirely. Woody Allen, Anne Frank, Steven Spielberg, Jaws, and all the rest of it. Jon Stewart, late night show, Jewish. Dustin Hoffman. How about Microsystems? Andy, I can't even pronounce his name. He owns Microsystems. A guy named Sergey Brin and a guy named Page developed and built Google. Do you know, does anybody in here know what Google is? What, it's a number. What does your Bible say about? It's a number. Revelation 18, 13, 18, it's a number. Google is a number. I think it's, what is it, Joel? What is it? It's 100. It's 100 zeros after it. That's what Google means. But the people who started Facebook, Zuckerman, he's a Jew. Google, it's Jews. They own it all. They built it all. They designed it all. They're God's chosen people, I'm telling you. Now, it's built into their family structure because Jewish people, especially the Orthodox, they don't monkey around like us Gentiles. They think, well, we have a good time till you're 20 and then get serious about life. They have bar mitzvah. At 13 years of age, you're considered a man, and you need to act like a man, walk like a man, and talk like a man. And you need to get started in business. And you need to start learning what it is to handle money. And they teach them all these principles. You can read about this. But anyway, Facebook. Guess who owns Baskin and Robbins? Jewish people. Guess who owns Ben and Jerry? Ben and Jerry are sodomites, but they're Jewish sodomites. Haagen-Dazs, those real nice ice cream bars. This really got me. They're Jewish. Dunkin' Donuts, owned by Jews. Y'all, you're excited, aren't you? And I don't mind it. It doesn't bother me. Let them own it. Amen. Hormel Beef Packing, Jewish. Swift Beef Packing, Jewish. Estee Lauder, is that come out of perfume? It's Jewish owned. H&R Block, Jewish owned. Goldman Sachs, Jewish owned. Oracle. Socks. Oracle's Jewish. Guess what? Snapple is owned by Jews. Starbucks is owned by a Jew. Toys R Us is owned by a Jew. Warner Brothers, owned by Jews. DreamWorks, film company, owned by Jews. Slimfast, owned by Jews. Calvin Klein clothes on the Jews. Levi Strauss. They clothed most American men for a long, long time in this country. Started back in the San Francisco in the gold mine days. Dell Communications, Jewish owned. Rothschilds. NASDAQ is owned by Jews. And I could go on and on. But I shared this a little bit with Joel, and I'm going to share a little bit of this with you. I don't know, some of you may be aware of this. How many is aware that there's something weird going on called AI? Jewish tech people are the developers and the scientists of AI tech. And this is not some, this is not me with some kind of conspiracy theory. This is a fact. You can check it out. You can check me out on this. They have a principle that is old in the Jewish anti-God culture. Now, wait, when I say anti-God, I'm talking about, how many knows that when Jesus Christ came, they were religious. Somebody kill that big old spider. He needs to be killed. Kill him like the devil right there in front of you. Anyway. I see them ladies jumping up. And we'll think that the Spirit of God's moving them in a minute. But how many knows when Jesus came, it was a dead religion. He said, you're taking people to hell. You're hypocrites. You're not leading people. And they had, what had they done? He said, you have made the word of God of none effect by what? Your traditions. The Jewish people, religious people, have what's called the Talmud. They're involved in mysticism and humanism. And they do recognize the existence of a God of some type. Now watch this. They're just now coming out with what's called Golem. It's G-O-L-E-M. This is an old Jewish term. Goes way back hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, even thousands of years. And Golem is it's a Hebrew word that's one time in your Bible. It's, guess, get this. It's in Psalms 139, verse 16. Does anybody know what it says there? There's a word called that he knew us while we were substance. I want to get it right. Because now I'm gonna tell you this kind of gets you, it gets me. Psalms 139. If I can get there. Here we go, verse 16. Thine eyes did see my substance. The people, the Jewish tech, high-tech people are aware of this verse. And they named the AI that you're seeing out here now, Golem, substance. And it's the word we get embryo from. Golem is an old Jewish outside the Bible. They took it outside the Bible. And here's what they said. Watch this. We're going to create human life. I don't know whether you're aware of this or not, but right now, there are tens and tens of thousands of American men who have AI girlfriends right now. Check me out on that. Get you an AI girlfriend right now. They're developing artificial life. It's called Golem, substance. And here's what they're doing. They are going to try to create artificial AI human life. Now this thing is well underway. It's not a joke. This is not a conspiracy theory. It's the truth. Here's why I bring this up. There's coming in the tribulation period an Antichrist who's going to be the beast, and he's going to be lifeless, but somebody's going to put power in him to speak. Artificial intelligence. But behind all this, what they don't recognize is Satan. And he's behind all this AI intelligence. And I'm telling you something. When I tell you that I believe Jesus is coming soon, I am not getting up here preacher talk. I am telling you, you better get ready for the trumpet to sound, because the stage is being set for an Antichrist that will be controlled by Satan. And it'll be in the form of artificial intelligence. Where, watch this. Ye, back to Genesis. Ye shall be as gods. Did you know that hundreds of years ago, the Jewish scholars who were devising this idea to create artificial human life, Their greatest fear was that if we accomplish this, we will lose control of it. And the reason that that's going to happen is because Satan is going to take control of the AI intelligence. And it'll manifest itself, I believe, in the Antichrist beast. Yes, brother. Yeah, there'll be a new Bible. In fact, they're writing one right now. They're writing a new artificially intelligent Bible. And it will be, it's a Bible for the Antichrist. Think about Christ. Christ has his word. The Antichrist will have his word. I mean, things are accelerating. I'm not trying to put the spooky on you tonight. I'm just telling you what the facts are. They're doing it now. There's already tens of thousands of Americans who have AI. You know what they say they like about it? If you don't like her, you're not married to her. Order another one. And this AI people, I read an article all about it. They said that, Jim, if you converse with her, in just seconds, they'll take all of your phone information. They know what you like, what you don't like. They know how you think, how you respond, because they've already got all your inputs that you've been putting in the phone all these years. And she will respond in a way that you like. Husbands, men, you have a wife that just agrees with everything you want. Wouldn't that be wonderful? I'm just joking. Listen, I'm going to quit. I can keep on. God's doing something right here, and I don't want to interfere with it no more. But I want to tell you something. He's coming back. We said we was going to focus on the second coming of Jesus Christ. And I'm telling you something. It's not some fairy tale. It's going to happen. Now, I guarantee you that when we get past this, we'll look back and say, aha, aha. Right now, I'm seeing through a glass darkly. I don't see very good. But what I'm seeing, Brother Marcus, it alarms me. It alarms me. It's real. It's real. If you're here tonight and you're not saved, I'd get saved. You say, Reggie, I'm just going to wait and I'll get saved during tribulation. I doubt that seriously. All righty. Let's stand together tonight. Folks are praying. You're here tonight, you're not saved, get a hold of somebody, make sure about your saved. Now you listen to me. I didn't tell you when he's coming, I just said he's coming. And he is coming. He said he's coming. It won't make a difference what I say. He's going to do what he said he would do. I love you in the Lord. In the morning, we'll kick in here about 9:30, 9:45, and then we'll have dinner on the grounds tomorrow. You know what? We said this is going to be camp meeting. We're going to rest. How many of you wore out like I am? I'm wore out. I didn't get my rest somehow or another. Hey, you're dismissed. We'll see you. Good night.